tonight, we are going to be discussing, the Lord gave us a word for this year in Christ Temple. And that word is greater works. That means that you and I are expected to do greater works for the Lord. But let me let you know that there are prerequisites as a child of God if you want to do greater work. There are things that there are requirements that you have to meet in order for you to do greater works. I'm just going to list about four or five of them, but I'm going to dwell only on just one of them tonight. One of the key things that you, in order for you to do the work that Christ did, and even greater, you have to grow to the level of Jesus Christ. Do you hear me? In order for you to do greater works, there must be growth in your Christian life in order for you to be able to do that. You must also acquire knowledge. Knowledge is absolutely important. Knowledge is absolutely important, you know, for you to be able to do greater work. There also must be a development of the inner man. There must be a development of the inner man. You are a tripartite being. You are made of the spirit, the soul, and the body. In order for you to be able to do greater works, your inner man, your spirit, must be developed. There must be transformation. There must be transformation that is evident in your life. And finally, there must be a refinement. There must be a refinement in your life. So, having said all this, let us open to our first two scriptures. You know, we are going to be dwelling so much on growth tonight. And the first scripture is taken from Luke chapter 1, verse 18. Luke chapter 1, verse 18. And I read, "And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, and was in the desert till the day of his showing unto Israel." That is talking about John. That's talking about John. The second reading is taken from Luke chapter 2, verse 14. "And the child grew and waxed strong, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him." That was talking about Jesus Christ. Let me let you know that despite the fact that Jesus Christ was the Son of God, he was born with all the power and authority, yet he has to grow from being a child to the level of manhood. And that when he was a child, he was helpless. And that is why the parents have to take him from one place to another when his life was being threatened by Herod. But when Jesus Christ grew up to be a son, he came back to confront his adversary. And that's why when he was being baptized in Jordan, the voice came and said, "This is my what? My beloved son." He has grown from being a child. There has been a transformation in his life. There has been a transformation, and God acknowledged that transformation and said, "This is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Hear him." Let me let you know that as a child of God, when you become born again, there must be a transformation. There must be a growth in your life, in your Christian life, in order for you to be able to do greater works. Jesus Christ did not do great works until he has arrived, until he has been refined, until he has been transformed from the level of a child to that of son. And in order for you to be able to do the same work that Jesus Christ did and even do greater, you have to be able to get to that level of sonship. And one of the requirements, as I said, you know, every child of God must have knowledge after you have come to know the Lord. Transformation spiritually must take place in your life. Let's see what 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3 to 4 says. Say, "This is good and acceptable in the sight of our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of truth. It is not just enough to be saved through the blood of Jesus Christ. In order for you to be able to do greater work, you need to acquire knowledge of the word of God. You need to have a sound, a sound knowledge of the word of God. Proverbs chapter 19, verse 2 says, also that the soul be without knowledge is not good. Knowledge is very vital for anyone who is aspiring, for anyone who is planning to do greater works this year. There must be an evidence of growth. There must be an evidence of acquisition of sound knowledge regarding generally about God, regarding generally about your Christian faith. Isaiah chapter 33, verse 3 says, and there shall be stability in thy times, abundance of salvation, wisdom, and knowledge. The fear of Jehovah is thy treasure. We overcome the devil by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. We need a deep understanding of the word of God. We need to know what the word says about God generally. We need to know what the word says about the doctrines of what it is to be a Christian. We need to, You know, Jesus Christ, when he was talking to that woman at the well, you know, and the woman was telling him about how their father worshiped on the mountains, Jesus Christ told him in John chapter 4, verse 7, says, ye worship that which ye know not, but we worship that which ye know, for salvation is from the Jews. And Hosea chapter 3, verse 6 says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. They are destroyed for lack of knowledge. They are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Let me tell you, brethren, what differentiates you as men and animals is the fact that there is a knowledge of God. And it is absolutely important, if you want to do greater works, that you have to seek knowledge through the word of God this year. John chapter 8, verse 31 says, Jesus therefore said unto those Jews that had believed in him, if ye abide in my word, if ye abide in my word, then are ye truly my disciples. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. You shall know the truth when you take time to study the word of God. The word of God is a complete book. It addresses every issue of life. And if you take time to study it, take time to meditate on it, you begin to receive revelation concerning every aspect of your life. When you want to make a decision, it becomes very easy because you'll be making the decision according to the revelation of the word of God. Let me let you know, as a child of God, it is the blood of Jesus that gives us salvation, but it is the word of God that makes us free. I repeat, it is the blood of Jesus that was shed on the Calvary, you know, that gave us redemption, that gave us salvation, forgiveness of sin. But when it comes to being set free, to get your liberty, Rebo Sinda Kariaba, it is the word of God. It is the word of God that you have in you that gives you that liberty, wherewith you are supposed to stand. Let's see what the advice that David gave to his son Solomon. And that can be seen in 1 Chronicles chapter 28, verse 9. 1 Chronicles chapter 28, verse 9. And let's see what the advice that that David gave to Solomon, his son. He says, and thou, Solomon, my son, know thou the God of thy father. And thou, Solomon, my son, know thou the God of thy father, and serve him with a perfect heart and with a willing mind. For Jehovah searcheth all hearts and understandeth all imagination of thoughts. Now, listen to what it says. It says, if thou seek him, he will be found of thee. If thou seek him, I'm telling you today, if you genuinely seek the Lord, If you genuinely seek the Lord this year, He will be found. That was the advice that David gave to his son Solomon. He said, if Solomon genuinely seek the face of the Lord, God is not too far. He will be found. He will be found. But now listen, he said, if thou forsake him, he will cast thee off forever. I pray that the Lord will not cast anyone of us off forever. Hosea chapter 6, verse 6 says, for I desire goodness and not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God more than burnt offering. The knowledge of God more than burnt offering. Let me tell you, apart from having the knowledge about God, there is also a need to have knowledge about other things. Let me tell you, pertaining your Christian life, because Christianity is not a religion. Christianity is a way of life. What did I say? Christianity is not a religion. It's not a religion of set of rules of do's and don'ts. It is a way of life. It is a way of life, and you as a child of God need to know the basic doctrines, need to know the basic information about everything pertaining to the life of a Christian. Some of us, when it's time, just a simple example, when it's time to receive communion, Christian that have been bought by the precious blood of Jesus, because of certain doctrines they have been used to in certain denomination, they will refuse to take communion. And that is nothing but ignorance. Those are the things that God wants to deliver us from. When there is so much benefit from taking the communion, when Jesus Christ instructed that we should do this as often in remembrance of Him. But because these brethren lack knowledge, they lack understanding. That is why, because they have been taught in certain denominations, I don't know whatever they have about against, taking communion. They come and they'll say, no, I don't want to take communion. God will help us. That is why the Bible, the Word of God says, you will know the truth. You will know the truth. And the truth that you know will set you free. Will set you free from all manners of bondages. Will set you free. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual sacrifice. Now, it says, be not be fashioned or be not be conformed by the, by the renewal of your mind. Do not be conformed according to this world. Do not be conformed according to the system of this world. Do not be conformed according to certain doctrines that are not biblical, that don't have any biblical foundation. He said, but be ye transformed. Be ye transformed. I talked about transformation. There is a need if we want to do great work for the Lord this year. Greater work. There is a need to be transformed, that our mind must be transformed. Mind must be transformed by the word of God. Our mind must be transformed. Our mind must be transformed by the word of God. He said, by renewing your mind, that ye may prove what is good and acceptable and the perfect will of God. The will of God is that every child of God must be transformed from the day he has been, he received Christ, when he's a baby in Christ. And then God expects us to begin to grow. And transformation begins to occur in our life. And refinement and being knowledgeable. Knowledge of God. And so that at a point we would have evolved and be like the very image of our master, which is Jesus Christ. And it is at that point that we begin to do greater works. Greater work. Greater work for the Lord. There is a need for us to be transformed by the Spirit of God in our inner mind. To such a degree that we live a way that Jesus Christ lived among men. If we are going to do the works that Jesus Christ did, as I said, even greater work, we have to undergo the same transformation that Jesus Christ went through. If we are going to do the works or greater works that Jesus Christ did, we have to undergo transformation that he underwent. And we have to get to a point where we resemble Christ. We resemble the image of Christ. According to the scripture that we read earlier in Luke chapter 2:14, we notice that Jesus Christ grew. The child grew according to that passage. Now, Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 says, unto us a child, what? A child is born. Unto us a son is given. You can see the transformation from being an ordinary child to that of a son that is given. And now, it is when he became a son, and you see what it says? It says, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called what? Wonderful. Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. But let me tell you, Jesus Christ came into this world as a child, but he did not stay a child. He grew. There is a need for a child of God. When you give your life to Christ, there is a need for you to stop drinking milk. You need to progress to the point where you begin to eat meat and you begin to crack bone and you begin to drink honey from the rock. What does it mean to grow? To grow is to improve. What does it mean to grow? To grow is to undergo maturation. You become mature Christian. What does it mean to grow? To grow is to increase in knowledge, increase in spiritual strength. To grow is what? Is to develop when you have a child. And that child, at the time that is supposed to be eating meat and drinking adult food, is still craving for only milk, you will see that that child will be malnourished physically. And the doctor will say this child has either marasmus or kwashiorkor. That means what simply says is that child is malnourished. Unfortunately, a lot of us Christians are malnourished spiritually. We give our life, we are quick to give our life to Jesus Christ, and we become born again. And then, instead of us to grow, we remain babes. We still warm the pew. At a point where we are supposed to be teachers, we still are craving to be taught. At the point where we are supposed to be eating meat and cracking bone, we are still drinking milk. This year, let there be a difference. Let there be a difference. Let there be a difference. Especially if you want to do greater works. If you want to do greater works. What is the advice of Peter? We can read that in 2 Peter verse 3, chapter 18. It says, but grow in grace and knowledge. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You know, to him be the glory both now and forever. But grow in grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Peter was saying that, you know, he said we must grow as children of God. As children of God. Let's see what Paul said to the Galatian church. He says, my little children, Paul called them little children because what? Because some people in the Galatian church refused to go. He said, my little children, of whom I am again in travail, until Christ be formed in you. I travail. Paul is saying that I am praying. Honestly, I am praying for you because the ultimate goal is that you are supposed to be transformed to the very image of Christ. But right now, you are not doing that. You are still remaining a baby. And I keep praying for you. I'm traveling for you. I'm praying after you have been taught. After you have been taught several times for so long that you are not supposed to be teachers. You are not supposed to be apostles. You are not supposed to be prophets. You are not supposed to be pastors. You still have a need to be taught like children. The elementary stuff. And unfortunately, that is what is responsible for the problem we have in our church. Because a lot of people remain to grow from being a child. And that's why there is a lot of backbiting. That's why there is a lot of jealousy. That's why there is a lot of competition. That is why there is a lot of things that are not appropriate going on. Because what people have refused to grow. That's why there is so much competition. That's why, you know. So see what Paul said in Hebrews chapter 5, verse 12. He says, "For when by reason of the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need again that someone teach you the rudiments." Rudiment, that is the elementary stuff. When you are supposed to be in college, you are still being taught, one plus one in the elementary school. It says, "For when by reason of the time, that you have given your life to Christ, you have been saved for 20 years, yet at this point when you are supposed to be teachers yourself, when you are supposed to be prophets yourself, when you are supposed to be pastors yourself, when you are supposed to be apostles yourself, when you are supposed to, to be teaching others." Paul says, "For by reason of the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need again that someone teach you the rudiments, the elementary stuff of the first principles of the oracle of God. And have become such as have need of milk." What does a child crave for? Milk. A child cannot eat that of food. And not of solid food. He says, now, see what he says in verse 14. He says, "For everyone that partaketh of milk is without experience of the word of righteousness. For he is what? A babe." For he is a babe. Verse 14 says, "But solid food is for full grown men, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern good and evil." I've been talking about this, the gift in the church. Ephesians 4:11 says, "And he gave some to be apostles, and some to be prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors, and some teachers." Why? Why did Jesus Christ give? Why did Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, give all these gifts? Listen, he says, "For the perfecting of the saints," for the perfecting of you and I, for the perfecting of the saints, for the perfecting of the saints, for the perfecting of the saints, for the perfecting of the saints. For the perfecting of the saints. Until the work of ministering, God expects you, as you have been saved, that you need to grow, and then you could begin to do the work of the ministry yourself. Until the building up of the body of Christ, God expects you to partake in the building up of the body of Christ. Now, verse 13, "Till we all attain unto a unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a full-grown man, unto the measure of the status of the fullness of Christ." Now, listen to verse 14. It says, "That we may no longer be children." That we may no longer what? Be children. "Tossed through and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine." It is absolutely important. That is why today you will hear that there is a prophet that came to this particular church, and everybody and who can tell you about what happened to you 10, 20 years ago, and everybody will start rushing there. Because they want the prophet to tell them about their life. Because they want the prophet to prophesy to them. Now, they are not even sure the source of the power of that prophet. Because there are so many prophets that are using familiar spirit to prophesy. There are so many prophets, even in the house of God, that are using familiar spirit to prophesy to people. Let me tell you. But when you are well grounded, When you are well rooted, you will not be running from pillar to post. And that's why you see some people today, they are in this church A. After 6 months, they jump to church B. After 1 year, they jump to church C. They have gone almost throughout to different churches in the city. They have not found anyone suitable for themselves. The Bible says we are trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord. If you are a tree that is planted, you don't move about. You stay and get nourished. I'm not saying that if your spirit does not agree with the particular church, you have to stay there forever. But my God, find a church where you are going to be taught the word of God, where your spirit will stay, and then you will begin to grow. You will become planted and put your roots down. Because it is when you become planted and put your roots down that you begin to bear fruit yourself. God is expecting you to bear fruit. God is expecting you to bear fruit. God is expecting you to begin to feed others. Let me remind you again. In order for you this year, 2021, don't make greater work just a slogan. Make it a goal. In order for you to achieve, and in order for you to do that, you must grow. You must grow. You must grow spiritually. You must grow spiritually. Look at what Samuel. Look at Samuel in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 26. And the child Samuel grew and increased in favor with Jehovah and also with men. The child Samuel. That is why God was able to use him mightily. He grew from being a child to a man, to a son. God is expecting us to grow. Now, let me you know, why is growth so important? We've been talking about growth and growth and growth. Why is it so important? First, I'll give you some reasons. One, growth is important to a child of God because growth is the will of God and is a part of his plan for you. I've read so many scriptures, in the course of this Bible study, where God is expecting you as a child of God. You know, once you've given your life to Christ, God does not expect you to remain a babe. God does not expect you to remain a babe. God expects you to grow. And let us go and read Colossians, the book of Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3, and I will read from verse 5. It says, mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth: fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry. For which things sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience. In the which ye also walk sometime when ye lived in them. Now listen to verse 8. But now ye put off all this: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Verse 9. Lie not to one another, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deed, and have put on a new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. When we're in the world, what are the things that we do? Fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, covetousness, idolatry. We get easily angered, We are involved with malice, blasphemy, filthy communication. We laugh at all kinds of filthy communication, and filthy communication coming out of our mouth. Oh my God, people can lie. Some of us can lie. We can lie both ways. But the word of God is saying that in order for you to grow, in order for you to be evident, in order for us to see the evidence of growth in your life, all these things will necessarily pass. Somebody who has been such a great fornicator or a great adulterer, who has been a great liar, who was filled with inordinate ambition. When he gave his life to Christ, and as part of growth, all these negative things begin to disappear in his life because his mind is being renewed on a daily basis by the word of God. And he's been transformed. And he's been transformed on a daily basis to look like our master, which is Jesus Christ. That is an evidence of growth. And that is somebody who is going to be able to do greater works for the Lord. What is the second reason why there is a need for us to go? There is a need for us to go because we have as examples people before us who do greater works. And I told you, in order for you, Jesus Christ was one of our examples. And John the Baptist was one of the examples among those people who do great works. And that is why when God asks us to do something, he shows us by giving examples of people who have gone before us who have been able to do it. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21 says, "For hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow his steps." And I repeat, "For hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow his steps. Who did not sin, neither God found in his mouth. Who when he was reviled not again. When he suffered, strengthened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously." God is expecting us to follow the examples of those who have gone up before us. People like Paul, people like Peter, people like Stephen. Those are examples. People like David, people like Abraham. We have cloud of witnesses that God is expecting us. If you are going to do, if you are going to do greater work this year, then we have to get our life transformed. Let me tell you, if a child of God does not become like Jesus, how can he do what he did? How can he do what Jesus Christ do? And if you are not able to do what Jesus Christ did, how can you do greater works? How can you do greater works? Let me tell you, we have been talking about greater works. Many of you might not understand one of the things that represent greater works. Let me let you know, when Jesus Christ said, "Greater work will you do," God, one of the greater work that Jesus Christ is expecting us to do this year is winning of souls. Do you know that when Jesus Christ was here, what did he do? He attracted and turned people unto himself. He talked about the kingdom of God. He was able to heal the sick, deliver the oppressed. But let me tell you, the salvation was not when Jesus Christ was here. Because why? Because he has not paid the price. So the job of winning souls has been left to us that are his disciples after his death. Salvation did not come until Jesus Christ shed his blood on the cross, died, was buried, resurrected, and then ascended and is seated at the right hand of God. So, in order for you to do greater works, one of the things that Christ is expecting you to do is to spend your time winning souls. And that's why he did not give the Great Commission until he was about to ascend. Let's go to Mark and see the Great Commission that Jesus Christ gave. The book of Mark. Oh, Mark, I hope you're getting something tonight. Mario Sindariaba. Yiribo Sinda. The book of Mark, chapter 16, and I'll read from verse 15. And he said unto them, go ye unto the world and preach the gospel, the good news, to every creature. Now, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. Now, see what it says. Verse 17. And these signs shall follow them that believe in my name. Are you a believer? Jesus Christ is saying that these signs shall follow you. In my name, they shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay their hands on the sick and they shall recover. These are the greater works that Jesus Christ is expecting us to do. Greater works. Laying of hands on the sick and they become healed. The shadow of Paul, or they lay sick people so that Paul can cast his shadow upon them and they receive healing. The handkerchief from Paul was healing people. And do we have people doing greater works here? Even what in our contemporary world? Yes. And is it meant for every child of God? Yes. But this grace to do greater works is not going to come upon you. Instead, you take the business of God seriously. And that business is so winning. So winning. That's why the word of God says, seek ye first the kingdom. Everything pertaining to the welfare of the kingdom. Seek ye first the kingdom and all his righteousness. And every other thing that men run after. Wealth, peace, victory, breakthrough, blessings. They will begin to run after you on their own accord. When you make God's business your business, and you make it a priority in your life, then every other thing begin to run after you. Begin to run after you. Let me let you know that the third reason for the need to grow is that the growth of a child of God pleases God. It makes God to be happy. And that's why I have told us in Matthew 3, chapter 17, and lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. This is my beloved son, in whom I'm well pleased. Because Jesus Christ has undergone transformation and is now attained the status of a son. And the word of God says, the voice came and said, this is my beloved son. This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. If you have a child that has undergone from being a child to a grown-up man and is doing great things, of course, as a parent, you will indeed be pleased. And you can say, look at my son. This is my son because he is doing what has pleased you. The fourth reason, God makes it possible for full potential to become manifest. Let me tell you, everybody is born with a potential. But until that potential is cultivated, until that potential is developed, we are not able to see the full manifestation of that potential. Everyone, every human being in this world has a potential. Potential means the capacity and the quality, you have to become, that you possess. The capacity and the quality that is inborn in you. You have to become something if you are well managed. You will become something if you are well managed. If that potential is well managed, you will become something. The word of God is the most creative thing. The more of the word of God in you, the greater your manifestation. Therefore, for you to do great works, you need to grow in grace in the word of God. In the word of God. In the word of God. The fifth reason why there is necessity for you to grow is that growth is important for a child of God to live an overcoming life. To live an overcoming life. To live an overcoming life. I told you that, when Jesus Christ was a child, because maturity has not come, because refinement has not come, because transformation has not come, his parents were afraid that he was going to be killed by Herod, so they took him to Egypt. But when Jesus Christ fully achieved the status of a son, he came back, able to confront those forces that were bent on destroying him. He was able to come back to confront them. Moses, who was supposed to be a deliverer, he was threatened by Pharaoh and he ran away. But by the time he grew to be a son, by the time he grew to be a mature individual after his experience with God in the backside of the desert, he came back to confront that same Pharaoh that he ran from and said, "Let my people go." He was able to confront Pharaoh. That means that maturity has taken place. Let me tell you, why is growth important? Growth is important because it's an evidence of a healthy Christian life. When you grow, it's a sign of a healthy Christian life. Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse 29 says, "The secret things belong unto the Lord our God, but those things which are revealed belong unto us and our children forever, that we may do all the word of his law." God rewards growth with more revelation and information. God can trust you with his information and with his revelation and with his secret when he sees that you have grown up. You are no longer a baby. Which are the areas, and as begin to round up, which are the areas of growth in our, in our personal life? God expects us to grow spiritually. We are a spirit, as I said earlier on, and we have a soul and we live in a body. Spiritual growth is accompanied by the feeding on the word of God. If you want to grow spiritually, you have to feed. Just like you feed your physical body with food and all the good things, you need to feed your spirit with the word of God. And that's where spiritual growth comes from. We also need to grow mentally. Mental growth. Proverbs 23:7 says, "As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he." Your thoughts must be mature thoughts. As a man thinketh in his heart, so he is. There is a need to achieve mental development and mental growth. There is also the third area of that God expects us to grow is our emotion. There should be an emotional growth. Some people are full of fear and anxiety. Every time somebody is running after them, they are fearful. When the word of God says, that we should be careful for nothing, but in everything through supplication and prayer, we should make our requests known unto God. He said, be careful for nothing. If you are not grown emotionally, when you are confronted with the challenges of life, people begin to break down. They are overtaken by anxiety. They are overtaken by depression. They are overtaken by unusual fear. There is a need for us as children of God to grow emotionally. There's also a need for us to grow financially. The fifth one is that you are supposed to grow relationally. Your relationship with your brethren, with your pastor, with workers in the church. You are supposed to grow in your relationship. 76, you are supposed to grow in your career, in whatever vocation that you have chosen. You want to be a teacher, you have a first degree, take a second degree, if possible. Go for a PhD. Whatever career that you have chosen, you need to be up to date with the current knowledge in your chosen profession. So I hope that as we begin to round up tonight, that the word of God that have been sown will take root in the Father's soil of your heart. And that this year, we shall truly do greater works. Let us pray. Father, Lord, we just want to thank you for what you have had tonight. Father, Lord, I pray, oh God, that this seed has been sown in the Father's soil of your children's heart, and that it will take root, and that it will germinate, and it will grow, and it will begin to produce seed of righteousness. Father, Lord, I pray, oh God, Father, Lord, God Almighty, that your children, oh God, Father, will not have stunted growth. They will not remain in the same place, but they would grow in grace this year, so that they will be able to do greater works, which is what you expect from us. Father, we thank you tonight. Oh God, we give you glory, we give you honor and adoration. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. I hope you have gained something tonight. Stay blessed. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen.